In this video, we're computing the moment of inertia of a right triangular slab where the rotation axis for the calculation of moment of inertia is collinear with the vertical side of the slab as we've shown in the diagram. So we're told this slab has a height of h and a base of b and a total mass of big M, and we're asked to compute the moment of inertia by breaking it into thin rods. Now there's actually two ways to do this. We could use horizontal thin rods or vertical thin rods. And in this video, we're going to do it by slicing this slab into horizontal rods. Now the vertical slice version, I'll do that in another video, and I'll post a link at the top when that's done. So there's a representative thin rod, and we give that an infinitesimal mass of dm. We locate it at a variable vertical position of y, and it has a thickness of dy. Note that the length of these horizontal rods is going to change continuously as y changes. When y is really small, we have longer rods, like all the way at the bottom of the triangle, they'd have a length of b. And then as y gets bigger, the length of the rods is continuously shrinking until we get to the very top of the triangle where the rods have practically zero width. So we need a couple little pieces of background information before we start setting up a moment of inertia integral here. First, the moment of inertia of a thin rod rotating about its end is 1/3 ml squared, and I'll post a link to the video where that was first derived. So that's what we're doing here. We're slicing into horizontal rods, and as this triangular slab is rotating about that vertical axis, those rods are all rotating about one end. Now the second point I want to make is a point about area density. So it's really convenient to use this concept of area density when we're doing moment of inertia integrals for two-dimensional objects. We normally notate that as sigma, and that's the mass divided by the area. So the units of area density would be kilograms per square meter. Notice that you can always turn that formula around to calculate a mass if you know its area by taking sigma times A. So we're going to use that concept in a couple places during this calculation. So now we want to start setting up our moment of inertia integral. And the idea is that we want to express the moment of inertia contribution coming from this single thin rod, and then we're going to use an integral to add all that up. So we can actually just start by talking about the moment of inertia contribution of that single thin rod. So we're going to call that di because it's an infinitesimal contribution to the total. So that gives me 1/3 times the mass of that little rod, which is dm, multiplied by the length of that little rod squared. And that variable length, we called it x in the diagram. So next we can replace dm with its mass calculated as sigma times area. So I have 1/3 times sigma, my area density, times the area of that thin rod. Well, the area of the thin rod is just length times height. So that's going to be an x times dy. And we can clean this up as 1/3 sigma x cubed dy. Now we have a problem here. We can't compute an integral when I have two different variables in this expression. I want to cook this down to a single integration variable to cover this entire triangular slab in these thin rods. So what we can do is express the width of each rod in terms of y. So if I go back and look at my diagram, I see that every y value is unambiguously connected to a single width determined by the height along the triangle. So we need to write down a relationship between x and y, and actually that's just the equation of the line connecting the two vertices here, one at the top of the triangle at 0h and the other at the bottom at b0. So if we can get an equation for that line connecting those two points, well, that gives us the relationship between x and y. So let's work on that relationship. I can think about this in slope-intercept form and say that y is equal to the slope. Well, that's rise over run, and our rise between those two points is negative h, while our run is b, okay, times x, and then plus the y-intercept. So now we can solve for x in terms of y. In other words, the width of a thin rod in terms of its vertical location. So we subtract h from both sides and then multiply by negative b over h. And we get that x is negative b over h times the quantity y minus h. Now to verify that this is correct, we can make sure that when y is equal to 0, we get a width of b for one of our thin rods. That would be a rod at the very bottom of the triangle. So if I imagine plugging in 0 for y there, I would end up with negative b over h times negative h, and the h's would cancel, the minus signs would cancel, and I get x equals b like I'm supposed to. Now I also want to check the other end. At the very top of the triangle, I should find a width of 0 when my height of a thin rod is equal to h. So if I sub in h for y, I actually get h minus h in this term, and that gives me a width of 0. Now I'm pretty confident that we've related these two variables correctly. So let's go back to our expression for di and keep working on that. I can write this now as 1/3 sigma times x cubed. Well, now we can write x in terms of y. That's negative b over h times the quantity y minus h. All right, this needs to be cubed and then multiplied by dy. So when I cube this thing, I'm still going to get that minus sign out in front. And I have negative b cubed over h cubed. So just moving all the constants together here, I have negative b cubed sigma over 3h cubed times the quantity y minus h cubed dy. And now we have the moment of inertia contribution of a thin rod written entirely in terms of a single variable y. So we can add all these up by integrating as y goes from 0 to h. So I'm going to say I is equal to the sum of all the di's. This is what an integral does. It's a summation device for adding up infinitely many infinitesimal contributions. And we'll go ahead and move all our constants out in front. So I have negative b cubed sigma over 3h cubed. And we're taking the integral here as y goes from 0 to h. And our actual integrand is y minus h cubed times dy. Now that integral is unremarkable. When I integrate y minus h to the third, I just get 1/4 y minus h to the fourth. Let's move that factor of 4 in the denominator out with our constants here, and I end up with negative b cubed sigma over 12 h cubed times y minus h to the fourth power evaluated from 0 to h. So when I sub in the upper limit there, I get h minus h, in other words, 0. So I'm not concerned with that limit. And then I subtract what I get when I sub in the lower limit. So when I sub in y equals 0, I end up with just a positive h to the fourth there. And three of those factors of h are going to cancel out with the ones in the denominator. So again, that lower limit was subtracted. That's going to fix this minus sign out in front. And I end up with a positive b cubed sigma times h. Remember, we had h to the fourth, but three of them canceled out. And then divided by 12. Now we could view that as the final answer for this moment of inertia integral, but based on the information we were given, which is the dimensions of the triangle and the total mass, we should be writing the moment of inertia in terms of the total mass instead of the area density. So now we go back to our definition of area density, and that's the total mass of this triangle divided by the area of the triangle, which is 1/2 base times height. A nicer way to write that is 2m over bh. So now we sub in 2m over bh in our result for the moment of inertia, and I have b cubed times 2m times h over 12 bh. So the h's are going to cancel out there. One factor of 2 is going to cancel, leaving us with a 6 in the denominator, and a b is going to cancel out, leaving us with a b squared in the numerator. So moving the fraction out in front, I can write this answer as 1/6 mb squared. So we look at our answer and we should verify just real quick that it has the correct dimensions. So this is going to carry units of kilograms times meters squared. We know that's the proper unit of moment of inertia, and we're done. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.